Quercetin is the most abundant flavonoid in the diet, and it's estimated that the average person consumes 10 to 100 milligrams of it daily, just from diet alone. And if you ever wonder what makes a food become a superfood, well, it's because of quercetin. It's been shown in dozens of studies to have anti-carcinogenic, anti-inflammatory, and antiviral activities, usually when combined with the use of bromelain as an anti-inflammatory enzyme. But in this video, I wanted to talk about what quercetin is, why it's beneficial, and whether or not quercetin is worth it. Also, real quick, guys, before we get started, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm and turn the bell on next to it to stay up to date with new weekly videos. Now, quercetin is found naturally in many plant-based foods, particularly in the outer layer or peel. The color of fruits and vegetables reflects the amount of flavonoids present in them, so keep that in mind. And some of the highest sources of quercetin is found in elderberries, red onions, white onions, and cranberries, all having bright and distinct colors. And how it compares with other nutrients, quercetin is a more powerful antioxidant than vitamin C, E, and beta carotene. And when it comes to multitasking, quercetin plays a number of different roles in the body. It wears a lot of hats. The first thing that it does is that it has a very strong antioxidant property, which enable it to scavenge free radicals, reduce oxidative stress, and protect against cellular damage. Secondly, quercetin's anti-inflammatory properties help stop the production of inflammatory cytokines and enzymes, making it useful for various inflammatory conditions. Thirdly, it has anti-cancer effects by inhibiting cancer cell proliferation and inducing apoptosis. And lastly, it has cardiovascular benefits such as lowering blood pressure, reducing cholesterol levels, and improving endothelial function. And because of the long list of use cases, we'll look at our journal of pharmaceuticals on quercetin, which I'll link down below, and just go down the list to see what we can find. It's interesting because they list capers as having 180.7 milligrams per 100 grams, which is pretty significant. And I've recently become a fan of capers. They don't taste that bad, actually. So let's briefly go over what we find without spending too much time on each aspect. For antioxidant activity, the presence of quercetin was found to reduce lactate dehydrogenase and H2O2-mediated cytotoxicity, which is great. For anti-cancer activity, numerous studies have reported that quercetin can induce apoptosis and cell cycle arrest in different cancer cell lines, such as those of breast, prostate, lung, and colon cancers. For anti-inflammatory activity, it was shown that quercetin can mitigate the negative effects of inflammation and hyperglycemia on vascular endothelium. The pathway looks like this, where you have Q representing quercetin, which I can go over in another video if you like. And as for anti-allergenic, quercetin has been shown to decrease mast cell degranulation and subsequent histamine release, thereby attenuating the allergic response. So you can see the research is ample. This is why quercetin is considered to be the most widely distributed and extensively studied flavonoid. There's just so much out there on it. Now the question is, why do quercetin supplements contain bromelain? Is bromelain necessary? Well, they add bromelain because it's a naturally occurring enzyme from pineapple stems, which is pretty neat since it helps increase the bioavailability of quercetin. You'll find different types of supplements: quercetin 3 glycoside, quercetin aglycone, isoquercetin, quercetin 7 rutinoside. There are various types. There's also quercetin dihydrate, which is mostly insoluble in water. It may not absorb as well as the others, so keep that in mind. And with all of these, the most common dosages are 500 milligrams taken twice daily. But here's the thing. It's also very possible to experience benefits when taking lower doses and getting all your quercetin from just your diet. You may not need a supplement if you already have a healthy diet rich in fruits and vegetables like onions and capers. Personally, this is just one that I will get from food sources and not supplement, but if you're looking for one, make sure it is from a reputable company that does third-party testing for purity and quality. I've left below a few that you could check out in the description below. Potential side effects that you have to know are headaches and tingling of the arms and legs, even though these are pretty rare. Just something I note for completion's sake. But as with any supplement, guys, consult with your doctor before taking quercetin, as it can interact with some medications, including antibiotics and blood pressure medicines like losartan, and should be by no means a reason to stop taking your medicines. At this point, there isn't enough evidence to say quercetin carries out all of its studied mechanisms in the body. So what works for in vitro and on mice might work differently on humans. This is one of those cases where you have to be the judge and weigh the pros and cons against your own goals, health history, and personal food philosophy. Click the video here that looks at the top three best turmeric curcumin supplements, which I have a feeling you'll enjoy a lot and you'll learn a lot from it as well. And let me know if you found this video useful, guys. And until then, I'll see you on the next one.